says I'm a miracle.
My daddy says I'm a special little guy.
I'm a princess.
I am a prince.
Mom says I'm an angel sent down from the sky.
My daddy says I'm a special little soldier. No one is as handsome, strong as me. Though just my tendency to bold, but I'm his little soldier. Hop, two, four, three.
My mummy says I'm a miracle. One look at my face and it's plain to see. Ever since the day Doc chopped the umbilical cord, it's been clear there's no peer for a miracle like me.
My daddy says I'm a special little soldier. No one is as bold or tough as me. Has my daddy told ya? One day when I'm older, I could be a soldier.
One can hardly move for beauty and brilliance these days.
Oh my God.
It seems that there are millions of these one in a million these days. Specialness is never good. Above average is average. Go figure. Is it some modern miracle of calculus that such frequent miracles don't render each one a miraculous?
My mommy says I'm a miracle. One look at my face and it's plain to see. Ever since the day Doc chopped the umbilical cord, it's been clear there's no peer for a miracle like me.
My mommy says I'm a precious ballerina. She has never seen a peer ballerina. She says if I'm keen, I have to cut down all the cream. But I'm a ballerina, so give me more pay.
What a dear, honey, look at mommy, grandpa, honey,
brother, brother, small pony,
smile for mother, take another.
Have you seen the school report?
He has a C on his report.
Why?
We'll have to change the school, the teacher's clearly falling short.
She's just delightful, so hilarious, and insightful.
Might she be a little brighter than a class, so yeah, she's definitely a boss.
Take another.
My mama says I'm a miracle. One look at my face and it's plain to see. Ever since the day Doc chopped the umbilical cord, it's been clear there's no peer for a miracle like me. My mommy says I'm a miracle. That I'm as tiny and as shiny as a miracle. You can be all cynical, but it's a truth empirical. There's never been a miracle, a miracle, as miracle as me.
Look, is this gonna take much longer, Doctor? I've got a plane to catch at 3. I'm competing in the biannual International Amateur Salsa Ballroom Dancing Championships in Paris.
You're getting on a plane, Miss Wormwood?
Of course I am. I always compete, Doctor. And this year, I have a secret weapon, Rudolph. He's part Italian, you know. Very supple. Has incredible upper body strength.
I think we need to have a talk.
So, what is it? What's wrong with me?
Do you really have no idea?
When?
Miss Wormwood, I want you to think very carefully. What do you think might be the cause of this?
Am I? Look, am I fat?
You're pregnant.
What?
I'm gonna have a baby.
But a baby, I don't want another one. Isn't there something you can do?
You're 9 months pregnant.
Antibiotics, so, oh my good lord, what about the biannual International Amateur Salsa Ballroom Dancing Championships?
A baby, Miss Wormwood, a child. The most precious gift the natural world can bestow upon us has been handed to you. A random human being, a life, a person, a wonderful new person is about to come into your life to bring love and magic and happiness and wonder.
Oh, bloody hell.
Every life I bring into this world restores my faith in humankind.
I'll push you in a minute.
Each newborn life, a canvas yet unpainted, this still unbroken skin, this uncorrupted mind. Every life is unbelievably unlikely. The chances of existence almost infinitely small. The most common thing in life is life.
Are you smoking a cigarette?
Oh my word, I'm sorry, Doctor. What was I thinking? It's gonna turn a proper smoke. My word, he's an ugly little thing.
This is one of the most beautiful children I've ever seen.
Where's his thingy?
His what?
His thingy. You know.
This child doesn't have a thingy because...
A boy with no thingy! Look what you've done, you stupid woman! The boy's defective!
Mr. Wormwood, this child is a girl. A beautiful, beautiful little girl.
Is there still time for the biannual international amateur sausage and ballroom dance?
Competition's finished! You missed it! Is there any chance you can exchange it for a boy?
Like the semi-formal, semi-Spanish gown I should be wearing in the semi-finals tonight. I should be dancing the tarantella, primavera italiano, not dressed in hospital cotton with an ouchie front bottom and this
can't find his Franken beans.
Every life is unbelievably unblind.
My mummy says I'm a miracle.
The chances of existence are infinitely.
My daddy says I'm a special little guy.
Most common thing in life is
1, 2, 4, 3.
And yet every single life, every new life is a miracle.
Mommy says I'm a lousy little worm. My daddy says I'm a bore. My mommy says I'm a jumped up little germ, that kids like me should be against the law. My daddy says I should learn to shove my pie hole. No one wants a small mouth girl like me. Mom says I'm a good case for population control. Dad says I should watch more TV.
Yes, sir. That's right, sir. 155 brand new luxury cars, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Are they good runners? Well, let me put it like this. You wouldn't beat them in a race. Yes, sir. They're good runners, sir. Yes, sir. So, how much?
Harry!
Hang on.
Look at this. She's reading a book. A book. That's not normal for a 5-year-old girl. I think she might be an idiot.
Listen to this. It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom.
Stop scaring your mother with that book, boy.
I'm a girl.
And she keeps on trying to tell me stories, Harry. Stories. I mean, who wants stories? It's not normal for a girl to be all thinking.
I'll call you right back. Can you please stop talking? I'm trying to make the biggest business deal of my life, and I need to listen to this. It's all your fault. You spend us into debt and expect me to get us out of it. What am I, a flaming escapologist?
Escapologist, she says. What about me then? I've got a whole house to look after. Dinners don't make away themselves, you know. If you're an escapologist, I might be an acrobat to balance that law. The world's greatest acrobat. I'm off to bleach my roots, and I shall be talking to you for the rest of the evening, you horrid little man.
But but I'm going to make us rich.
Rich? How rich?
Very rich. Russian businessmen. Very, very stupid. I'm going to sell them 155 naked old beggars' ass. Brand new luxury cars.
But that's not fair. The cars will break down. What about the Russians?
Fair? Listen to the boy.
I'm a girl.
Fair doesn't get you anywhere in life, you thick-headed twit brain. All I can say is, thank heavens Michael inherited his old man's brains.
Michael.
Well, I shall take the money when you earn it, and I shall spend it, but I shan't enjoy it because of the despicable way you have spoken to me tonight.
This is all your fault. You and your stupid books and your stupid reading.
But I didn't do anything. That's not right.
Right? Right? I'll show you what's right. You'll be going off to school in a few days' time. And I know your headmistress, Mrs. Agatha Trunchbull. She's a great, big, strong, scary woman she is. Used to the hammer in the Olympics. She definitely won't be letting you get right there. Now, get off the bed and stay in bed, you nasty little bookworm.
Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. So they say the subsequent fall was inevitable. They never stood a chance, they were written that way. Innocent victims of their story. Like Romeo and Juliet, 'twas written in the stars before they even met. That love and fate and a touch of stupidity would rob them of the hope of living happily. The endings are often a little bit gory. I wonder why they didn't just change their story. We're told we have to do what we're told, but surely sometimes you have to be a little bit naughty. Just because you find that life's not fair, it doesn't mean that you just have to grin and bear it. If you only take it on the chin and wear it, nothing will change. Even if you're little, you can do a lot. You mustn't let a little thing like little stop you. If you sit around and let them get on top you, you might as well be saying you think that it's okay, and that's not right. And if it's not right, you have to put it right.
Platinum blonde hair dye, extra strong, keep out of reach of children. Oil of olive hair tonic, for men. Yep.
In the slip of a bolt, there's a tiny revolt. The seed of a war in the creak of a floorboard. A storm can begin with the flap of a wing. The tiniest light packs the mightiest sting every day. Starts with the tick of a clock, all escapes. Starts with the click of a lock. If you're stuck in your story and want to get out, you don't have to cry, you don't have to shout. Cause if you let all you can do a lock, you mustn't let a little thing like that'll stop you. If you sit around and let them get on top you, won't change a thing. Just because you find that life's not fair, it doesn't mean that you just have to grin and bear it. If you always take it on the chin and wear it, you might as well be saying you think that it's okay, and that's not right. And if it's not right, you have to put it.
Naughty.
this song. A man's hair is his greatest asset. Good hair means good brain. Now, the secret to my success in businesses.
Secrets?
Yes, the secret. The secret to my success in businesses. This Royal of Violet's hair tonic for men. Now, stand back, son, and watch your old man go to work. Ah, yes, that's the stuff. That's the bananas right there. Yes, yes, yes. And voila, a man in business simply cannot fail to be noticed when he looks like this.
Secrets.
Your hair, it's green.
Good Lord, woman, you've started already. It's not even a day. Ah, my hair, it's green.
What on earth did you use that for? Why do you want green hair?
I did not do that. I did not want a green hair.
Maybe you used some of Mommy's peroxide by mistake.
That's exactly what you did, you stupid man.
I've got my deal today. The Russians, what am I gonna do?
I know what you can do.
What is it? What can I do?
You can pretend you're an elf.
Yes, that's it. I'll pretend I'm a... What are you talking about, you fool? The boys are learning.
Mom, would you like to hear a story?
Don't be disgusting. Go creep on back to that library of yours or something. The sooner you're locked up in school, the better.
Hi, Miss Phelps.
Hello, Matilda. Back at the library again, are we?
Oh, yes. Well, my mother wanted me to stay at home with her, of course. She hates it when I go out. She misses me so much. Dad, too. He loves having me around. But I think it's good for grown-ups to have their own space.
Oh, Matilda, your parents must be so lucky to have a girl as clever as you. And do you tell them lots of stories like you tell me? Oh, Matilda, I do love your stories. That's not a hint, by the way. But if you did happen to have a story you want to share...
Oh, sorry. Bye, Miss Phelps. See you next week.
Bye, Miss Honey. Good luck with the Tolstoy. As I was saying...
Who is that lady?
Oh, that's Miss Honey. She's going to be your new teacher.
That lady is my...
Yes, that lady's your teacher. Now, are you going to tell me a story or not?
Once upon a time... Once upon a time, the two greatest circus performers in the entire world, an escapologist who could escape from any look ever invented, and an acrobat who was so skilled it seemed she could actually fly, fell in love and got married. They performed some of the most incredible feats anyone had ever seen, and people would come from miles around. Kings, queens, celebrities, and astronauts. But not just to see their skill, but to see their love for each other, which was said to be so deep, cats would purr as they passed and dogs would weep with joy. They moved into a beautiful old house at the edge of town. And at night, they would walk and take in the air. And at night, the children of the town would wait in anticipation, hoping for a glimpse of the acrobat's shiny white scarf. For then, they knew they just had to cry, "Tricks! Tricks!" And the two performers would instantly oblige with the most spectacular show just for them. But although they loved each other, although they were famous and everyone loved them, they were sad.
Everything.
We have everything that the world has to offer, said the wife.
We have everything.
But we do not have the one thing in this world that we want most.
But the one thing.
We do not have a child.
Patience, my love.
Patience, my love, replied the husband. Time is on our side. Even time loves us. But time is the one thing that no one is master of. And as time passed, they grew quite old and still they had no child. And at night, they would listen to the sounds of their big, empty house and imagined how beautiful it would be if it was filled with the sound of a child playing.
Oh, Matilda, this is very sad.
Do you want me to stop?
Don't you dare.
The sadness overwhelmed them and drew them on to ever more dangerous feats. as their work became the only place they could escape the inescapable tragedy of their lives. And so, it was then that they decided they would perform the most dangerous feat ever known to man. "It is called," announced the husband to the world press, who gathered to listen with bated breath. "The burning woman hurling through the air with dynamite in her hair over sharks and spiky objects caught by the man locked in the cage, and it is the most dangerous feat ever known to man." "It is our destiny," replied the wife, smiling sadly and lifting her hand up to his. "It is where the loneliness of our lives have led us."
"Well, what happened?"
I don't know. Not yet, anyway."
"What? No, please, just a little more something. Well, I guess your mother must be here. Is she here, by the way? I'd actually—
"By myself, I'll see you tomorrow."
"Love to meet her after your first day of school."
Says I'm a miracle.
My daddy says I'm his special little guy.
And I am a prince.
Mom says I'm an angel.
Mom says I'm an angel.
Mom says I'm an angel.
Inside the grave!
Messed by being a prince or a princess, you soon see.
There's no escaping tragedy. And even if you put in heaps of effort, you're just wasting energy. Cause your life doesn't know it is ancient history. I am so put in this jail. I'm trapped inside this cage for ages. This living hell. But if I thought I can remember, but before my
you want to suffer, listen up and I will teach you a thing or two. You listen here, my dear, we punish the feeling. If you step out of line and if you cry, then we tell you to stay out of trouble and remember to be extremely careful.
Why?
Why?
Why? Why? Did you hear what he said?
Just you wait for Phase Ed.
What's Phase Ed?
Physical education! It's the trench ball speciality!
My mommy says I'm a miracle.
My daddy said I will be the teacher's pet.
Dad, I learned the alphabet.
The alphabet? You gotta learn to listen, kid.
It's how you think you're able to survive this mess by being a prince or a princess. You will soon see there's no escaping tragedy. And even if you put in heaps of effort, you're just wasting energy. Cause your life as you know it is ancient history. I have suffered in this jail. I've been trapped inside this cage for ages. This is living out. But if I die, I can't remember that before my life had ended, before my happy days were over, before I first heard the pealing of the bell. Like it was curious, so listen, I asked a thousand questions. Oh, unless you want to suffer, sit up and I will teach you a thing or two. You listen here, my dear, you put us as a villain. You step out of line and you cry, but we don't. We should stay out of trouble and remember to be extremely careful.
Why?
Oh my God.
Why?
Why? Why? Did you hear what we said?
Good.
just to wait for Vincent. Just to wait for Vincent.
Children, today is a very special day. Your first day in school. My name is Miss Honey and I'll be your teacher. Do any of you know your twos times tables? Wonderful. Matilda, isn't it? Please stand up and do as much as you can.
1 times 2 is 2, 2 times 2 is 4, 3 times 2 is 6, 4 times 2 is 8, 5 times 2 is 10, 6 times 2 is 12, 7 times 2 is 14, 8 times 2 is 16, 9 times 2 is 18, 10 times 2 is 20, 11 times 2 is 22, 12 times...
Well, my word, that's very...
13 times 2 is 26, 14 times 2 is 28, 15 times 2 is 30, 16 times...
Stop, stop, good heavens, how far can you go?
I don't know, quite a long way, I think.
Do you think you could tell me what 2 times 28 is?
56.
Well, yes, that's... Very good. No, this is much harder, so don't worry if you don't get it, but if you took your time, do you think that you could maybe tell me what 2 times 487 is?
974.
12 sevens.
84.
I think we'd better leave maths for the time being and take a look at reading. Says.
Oh, me. Pick me. Please, please, please.
Nigel? I think we'd better leave it at that. We wouldn't want you to burst a blood vessel on your first day. Lavender?
Is the first word tomato?
No, but tomato is a very good word. Matilda?
I can now read words.
So, Matilda, you can read words?
Oh, yes. Well, I had to learn to read words so I could read sentences, because basically a sentence is just a big bunch of words. And if I can't read sentences, then I've got no chance at books.
And have you read a whole book yourself, Matilda?
Oh, yes. More than one. Last week I read quite a few.
A few? In a week? That's incredible. What are some of the books that you've read?
Nicholas Nickleby, Oliver Twist, Jane Eyre, Tessa the Dubervilles, Lord of the Ring, Crime and Punishment, Kim, The Secret Garden, and Stick of the Gum.
Knock on the door, Jenny, just knock on the door. Don't be pathetic. Knock on the door, Jenny. There's nothing to fear. You're being pathetic. It's just a door. You've seen one before. Just knock on the door. Look at you trying to hide, silly. Standing outside the principal's office like a little girl. It's just pathetic. Look at you hesitating, hands shaking. You should be embarrassed. You're not a little girl. It's just pathetic. Knock on the door, Jenny. What are you waiting for? Just knock on the door. Perhaps I will wait. She's probably having a meeting or something and won't want to be interrupted. If anything, caution in these situations is sensible. One should avoid confrontation where possible. I'll come back later then. But this little girl, knock on the door, Jenny. Just knock on the door. Stop being pathetic.
Enter. Well, don't just stand like a wet tissue. Get on with it.
Well, yes, headmistress, there's in my class a little girl, Matilda Wormwood.
Daughter of Mr. Harry Wormwood, who owns Wormwood Melters. Excellent man. Told me to watch out for the brat there. Said she's a real wart.
Oh no, I don't think Matilda's that kind of girl at all.
What is school motto, Miss Honey?
Bambinatum est magitum.
Bambinatum est magitum. Children are maggots. You know, it must have been her with that sink bomb under my desk this morning. I'll have her for that. Thank you for suggesting it.
What? But I didn't say that at all.
Nonsense. Haven't I just told you she's a gangster?
But she knows her times table.
So she's learned a few tricks.
But she can read.
So can I.
I have to tell you, headmistress, that in my opinion, Matilda Wormwood should be placed in top form with the other 11-year-olds.
What? But she's a shrimp, she's a squib, she's not had to topple. We cannot just place her with the 11-year-olds. What kind of society would that be? What about the rules, honey? The rules.
I believe Matilda Wormwood is an exception to the rules.
An exception? To the rules. In my school? Look at these trophies, see how my trophies gleam in the sunlight, see how they shine. What do you think it took to become English hammer throwing champion? 1969, do you think in that moment, when my big moment came, that I treated the rules with casual disdain? Well, like hell, as I stepped up to the second did I change my plan? What? As I chalked up my palms, did I wave my hands? I did not! As I started my spin, did I look at the view? Did I drift off and dream for a minute? Or two, do you think I faltered or amended my rotation? Do you think I altered my intended elevation? As the hammer took off, did I change my grunt from the grunt I had practiced for many a month? Not a jot, not a dot, did I stray from the plot? Not a detail of my throw was adjusted or forgotten. Not even when the hammer left my hands and sailed higher up above the sands, did I let myself go? Now. If you want to throw the hammer for your country, you have to stay inside the circle all the time. And if you want to make the team, you don't need happiness or self-esteem. You just need to keep your feet inside the line. Sing, children. 2, 3, 4.
If you want to throw the hammer, but you're bombing not so less magitum, you have to stay inside the circle all the time. Circular magitum, magitum.
Little squints to tear the line. Sing, Jenny! 2, 3, 4!
If you want to throw the hammer for your country, you have to stay inside the circle all the time.
I apply just one simple rule to hammer during life and school. Life's so bold, so learn to throw it. Find the valley line and turn it, and always keep your feet inside the line. Now get out.
Well, I must tell you, headmistress, that it is my turn to tell this little girl, whether you like it or not.
Stupid, nasty, stinking, sliming! How dare they speak to me like that? Who do they think they are? Flipping, flaming, filthy Russians!
Oh, don't tell me we're not rich!
It's the mileage! They took one look at the mileage on the first car and said, these cars were knackered! I tried to tell them it was a manufacturing mistake.
Is that true?
Of course it's not true!
So you lied?
Of course I lied.
And they didn't believe you?
Of course they didn't believe me. I've got green hair.
I've got hair.
And what's this? Another flaming book? What's wrong with the telly?
She got no respect, that one. It's all books and stories.
No, it's a lovely book. Honest, you should read it. I'm sure that you...
Lovely? Here's what I think of your lovely.
It's a library book. Stop! It's from the library!
You show that little brat!
Do we have any super glue?
It's in the cupboard. And while you're at it, how about you glue your stupid book to your stupid head?
Just because you find that life's not fair, it doesn't mean that you just have to grin and bear it. If you always take it on the chin and wear it, nothing will change. Even if you're little, you can do a lot. You mustn't let a little thing like little stop you. If you sit around and let them get on top you, you might as well be saying you think that it's okay, and that's not right.
I've got my eye on you.
Time to go.
Feels great.
Feels great, though.
Matilda, can I ask you a question? Do all those brains in your head give you a headache? I mean, it's good to have being all squished in there.
No, it's fine. I think they just fit.
Right, well, I'd better stick around just in case you start spilling out your ears or something. I'm Lavender, by the way, and I think it's best we become best friends.
Hide me, hide me! Someone's poured a whole can of treacle onto Trunchbull's chair. She sat down, and when she got up, her knickers stayed stuck to the seat. Someone said, I did it, but I never. Now she's after me.
But that's not fair.
You're done, kid. You're finished.
Once Agatha Trunchbull decides you are guilty, you are squished!
Yesterday, she caught Julius Rotwinkler eating a licorice all sort during science class. She just picked him up, swung him around, and threw him at the window.
That's not true. That didn't happen. They're just trying to scare us.
They're saying she's gonna throw me in Chokey.
What's Chokey?
It's a cupboard in her office she throws children into. They say she's lined it with nails, spikes, and bits of broken glass.
There's a place you are sent if you haven't been good, and it's made of spikes and wood. And it isn't wide enough to sit, and even if you could, there are nails on the bottom, so you'd wish you stood. When the hinges creak and the door is closed, you cannot see spot, not the end of your nose. And when you scream, you don't know if the sound came out or if the scream in your head even reached your mouth.
All right, look, when did this happen?
20 minutes ago, but why? Oh no, she's coming!
You better hide, quick, blazes.
Oh, Matilda, please don't tell her where I am.
Now.
Where's the McNanas, Nigel?
He's over there under those coats. Where he's been for the last hour, actually.
What? An hour?
Oh yes, well, you see, unfortunately, Nigel suffers from the rare but chronic sleep disorder, narcolepsy. The condition is characterized by the sufferer experiencing bouts of chronic fatigue or falling suddenly asleep, often without warning or any knowing at all, really. You see, Nigel fell asleep and we put our coats over him for safety, didn't we?
Didn't we?
Of course!
Totally!
Of course, yes. Of course. Snarklepsy.
You probably think he's in bed when he wakes up.
Is it time for school yet?
Mom, this isn't my bedroom. Oh, hello, Miss Trunchbull.
Amanda? Rick! Yes, Miss Trunchbull? What have I told you?
About pigtails.
I hate
pigtails.
But Mummy likes them. She says they make me look pretty.
Then your mother is a twin!
Go!
Go!
Matilda Wormwood.
Ah, Wormwood, are you? I might have known. Well, Wormwood, you have just made a big mistake.
Just so you know, she's my best friend.
Yes, sir, that's right, sir. 155 brand new luxury cars, sir. Yes, sir, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Green hair. Well, it was National Green Hair Day, a celebration of all things great, green, and wonderful in the world, such as lettuce and snow. So, yes, sir, yes, sir. So, 1 p.m. tomorrow? Yes, sir. That's good, sir. Dr. Medooda.
Won't come off. Well, I'll keep this on. It looks like rain.
Where are those stairs?
Who is it?
It's Miss Honey, Matilda's teacher.
Bit busy right now.
It will only take a moment.
Oh well, come in if you must.
This is Rudolph, though. It's nothing like that. He's my dad's partner. We're rehearsing.
Ciao.
Ah, parlo italiano. Bene come stai, Rudolfo?
What? Babes, you know what interruptions do to my energy flow.
What do you want, Miss Honey?
It's Miss Honey. Well, as you know, Matilda's in the bottom class, and children in the bottom class aren't really expected to read, and...
Then stop her reading, then. Lord knows we've tried.
Babes, I'm on fire here.
Look, Miss Hussey, I'm not in favor of girls getting all clever pants. Girls should be thinking about makeup and hair dye. Looks are more important than books. Now look at you, and look at me. You chose books. I chose looks.
But Matilda can calculate complicated figures in her head in an instant.
Calculate this.
A fantastic girl!
Her mind is incredible. With a little help from us, she could...
Mind? Her mind? You must not know anything, do you? Somewhere along the way, my dear, you've made an awful error. You ought to blame yourself now. Come along. You seem to think that people like people are clever. It's very quaint. Sweet, but wrong. People don't like smarty pants will go round claiming that they know stuff we don't know. Now here's a tip, what you know matters less than the volume with which what you don't know is expressed. Content has never been less important, so stick out from the crowd. A little less black, a lot more here. A little less back, a lot more fear. A little less brains, a lot more hair. A little less head, a lot more derriere. No one's gonna tell you what to shake your tush. Well, you got light, go hide it under a bushel. No one's gonna look if you don't stand out. No one's gonna listen if you don't shout. No one's gonna care if you don't care. So go and put some highlights in your hair, cause you gotta highlight what you got. Even if what you got is not a lot, you gotta be loud. You gotta give yourself permission to shine, stand up and be proud, proud, proud. A little less, a lot more thing. A little less, a lot more swing. A little less dressing like your mum. A little more bada ba 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 da bum. I look nice, you don't. No one's gonna tell you what to wiggle your bumba.
No one's gonna love you if you don't know the rumba.
Everybody loves a little something exotic.
But learning a language is over the top.
It doesn't really matter if you don't know now.
As long as you don't know with a bit of clout.
The less you have to sell, the harder you sell it. The less you have to say, the louder you yell it. The dumber the act, the bigger the confession. The less you have to show, the louder you dress it. You gotta get up, you gotta get up.
Get on your feet, Jenny. You are going to march in there and give them a piece of your mind. Leave it alone, Jenny. The more that you try, the more you'll just look like a fool. This is not your problem. You've not got the spine. You are a teacher. Just go back to school. She's found me, pathetic little me, and another door closes, and Jenny's outside.
And so the great day arrived. It was like the entire world had gathered to watch the burning woman hurl into the air with dynamite in her hair over sharks and spiky objects caught by the man locked in the cage. Everything was arranged by the acrobat's sister, a frightening woman who was an Olympic class hammer throwing champion and who loved nothing more than to scare the children of the town. People whispered that in her dark and brooding heart, she resented her sister, both her success and her love. The escapologist came out in his usual spangly costume and tights, but there was no sight of the acrobat and no glimpse at all of her shiny white scarf. And instead of the usual musical fanfare, there was silence as he solemnly strode out into the center ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, the burning woman hurling through the air with dynamite in her hair over sharks and spiky objects caught by the man locked in the cage has been cancelled. No! The audience gasped so loud, a passing airplane caught it on instrumentation and reported it as an atmospheric phenomenon. Cancelled because my wife is pregnant.
Oh, Matilda.
Absolute silence. You could hear a fly burp. Then, suddenly, the audience jumped to his feet and roared in its appreciation. The great feat was instantly forgotten, and the applause went on for nearly an hour.
So a happy ending after all.
Forgotten by everyone, that is, except the acrobat sister. When all had quieted down, she stepped forward and produced a contract.
A contract?
A contract you have signed.
You are to perform this feat, and perform this feat you shall. I have paid for the posters, publicity, the catering, the toilet facilities. If I give the crowd their money back, where is my profit? A contract is a contract is a contract. My hands are tied. The burning woman hurling through the air with dynamite in her hair over sharks and spiky objects caught by the man locked in the cage will be born upon this day or off to prison you both shall go!
Miss Phelps, are you crying? Maybe I shouldn't tell the story anymore.
No, we must find out how it ends. And I'm not crying because it's sad. I'm crying because it must be so lovely to be loved so much.
Yeah, wonderful. I'd better go.
Matilda, could I speak to you for a moment? I'm afraid I haven't been too successful in getting others to recognize your abilities. So I was thinking I could go to the library and get some very challenging books for you to read, and you could sit in the back in the classroom and read them while I teach the others. And if you have any questions at all, I'll try my best to answer them. How does that sound? Matilda, that's the biggest hug anyone's ever given me. You're going to squeeze all the air out.
Matilda Wormwood,
yes,
where is...
Trunchbull.
Ah, so you admit it, do you?
Admit what, Miss Trunchbull?
This clot, this foul carbuncle, is none other than a criminal, a denizen of the underworld, a member of the Mafia. This morning, you sneaked like a serpent into the kitchen and stole a slice of my private chocolate cake from my tea tray.
No, I did not.
Miss Trunchbull, Matilda's been here all morning.
Ah, setting up for a little spitball, aren't you? Well, this crime took place before school started, therefore, she is guilty!
Okay, look. All right. I stole the cake. And I was definitely sort of kind of thinking about owning up. Maybe. But the thing was, I was having a lot of trouble with my belly. You see, the Trunchbull's cake was so good that I had scoffed it down too quick, and now it was beginning to fight back. Oops. You see,
I'm not guilty. I didn't do anything.
You are guilty because you're a fiend. You are a crook, and I shall crush you. I shall pound you. I shall dissect you, madam. I shall consign you to the seventh circle of hell, child. You shall be destroyed!
It was the biggest burp I had ever done. It was the biggest burp I had ever heard. The biggest burp I had ever heard about. It was like the entire world went silent for that burp to exist, as a huge cloud of chocolatey gas wafted from my mouth and drifted across the classroom, past Alice, past Lavender, past Matilda, and then my great, big, beautiful, chocolatey burp, which now seemed to have a mind of its own, wafted full into the face of the Trunchbull.
Bruce? Bog Trotter.
Yes, miss?
You liked my cake, didn't you, Bruce?
Yes, Miss Trunchbull, and I'm very sorry, but...
As long as you enjoyed the cake, that's the main thing.
Is it?
Yes, Bog Trotter. It is.
Oh, well, I did, thank you.
Wonderful. Marvelous. It makes me so happy. It gives me a warm glow in my lower intestine. Oh, cook. What's the matter, Bog Trotter? Lost your appetite?
Well, yes, miss, I'm full.
Oh, no, you're not full. I shall tell you you're not full. And I say that criminals like you are not full until you've eaten the entire cake!
But...
No buts. You haven't got time for but. Eat.
But I can't eat at all.
Headmistress, he'll be sick!
He should have thought of that before he made a pact with Satan and decided to steal my cake. Eat!
He can't!
Eat!
He surely can't!
Eat!
He can't!
Eat!
Eat!
A single slice, or even two, Bruce, might have been nice, but even you, Bruce, have to admit, between you and it, there's not a lot of difference in size. He can't! He can't! He surely can't! He surely can't! You're the man, Bruce! He might explode, he's quite a
Headmistress, I got carried away.
That's all right, Jenny. We all get carried away sometimes, even me.
Well done, Bog Trotter.
Good show. Well, come along.
What?
Oh, did I fail to mention? That was the first part of your punishment. There's more. The second part. And that part is... choking!
No, Miss Trunchbull, please, you can't!
Please, Miss Trunchbull, yes, you can't! I'm not going to allow myself to be fooled by these maggots.
Hmm?
Who do you think I am? A weakling? A fool? An idiot? You?
But Miss Churchill, he ate the entire thing. He did what you asked.
Come along!
No, stop! That's not right!
Please, not Chucky, please!
Some of the things that have been going on here tonight. They're not nice things, and they are not right things. And I'd like to state guarantorically that we do not want any children that might be here tonight watching this to go home and try these things out for themselves. I am, of course, talking about reading books. It is normal for kids to behave in this fashion. It stunts the brain, wears out the eyes, makes kids ugly, stinky, fatty, sweaty, betty, boring, gaseous, and crucially, it gives them varicas of the mind. Under no circumstances do we condone such behaviors. Now, I would like to ask a question. How many people here have ever read a book? Please raise your hand. You, madam, in the orange tracksuit, what is your name? Yes, yes, you. Well, Miss Julia, please do not take this the wrong way, but you're a worm, a stupid bookworm. Worms read books, worms are stupid. You read books, you're a swam, a stupid worm. Now, Miss Julia will learn from that. She won't learn to stop reading books, but she will learn to never raise a hand in a theater again. Now, it is my pleasure to present the pinnacle of our achievements as a species, the very reason we bothered evolving from unicorns in the first place. Somewhere on a show I heard, a picture tells 1,000 words. So, tell me, if you're bothered to look, is equivalent to like lots of books. All I know I learned from Telly, this big beautiful box of facts. If you know a thing already, baby, you could see the tunnel over just like that. Endless joy and endless laughter. Folks living happily ever after. All you need to make you wise is 23 minutes plus advertisements. Why would we waste energy? Turn in pages, 1, 2, 3. And we can sit comfortably on the lovely Buckley's. Watch with people singing and talking and doing stuff. All I know I learned from Telly. The bigger the telly, the smarter the man. You can tell from my big telly just how clever of a fella I am. Take it away, son. You can't learn that from a stupid book. All I know I learned from Telly. This big beautiful book's the facts. Endless, just you already. Whoa. Endless content, endless shadow on endless funnels. All you need to fill your muffin without having to really think of nothing. Why would we waste energy trying to work out Ulysses? And we can sit happily on a lovely bubbly's while the slightly famous people talking to really famous people. All I know, I learned from telly. The bigger the telly, the smarter the man. You can tell from my big telly just how clever of a fella I am. Who the Dickens is Charles Dickens? Mary Shelley? She sounds smelly. Charlotte Bronte? Do not want to. Jane Austen in the composting. James Joyce does not sound nice. Ian McEwan, I feel like spewing. William Shakespeare, William Shakespeare. Moby Dick? Easy, Grandma. All together now. All I know, I learned from Sally. And I dig at the telly, the smarter the man. You can tell from my big sonny what a very clever fella I am. God, I'm smart.
By the way, Matilda's best friend. And there's a bit coming up that's all about me. Well, not exactly about me, but I play a very big part in it. And I'm not gonna tell you what it is because I don't want to spoil it for you. Okay, so basically what happens is I volunteer to get the transport jug of water, and on my way back, On my way back, I find this thing called a newt. A newt is basically this very large, ugly lizard that lives in water. So I pick it up and I'm gonna put the newt in the transport jug of water and it's gonna be brilliant!
When I grow up, I will be tall enough to reach the branches that you need to reach to climb the trees you get to climb when you're grown up. And when I grow up, I will be smart enough to answer all the questions that you need to know the answers to before you're grown up.
And when I grow up, I will eat sweets every day on the way to work, and I will go to bed late every night. And I will wake up when the sun comes up, and I will watch cartoons until my eyes go square. And I won't care, 'cause I'll be all grown up when I grow up. When I grow up.
when I grow up, I will be brave enough to fight the creatures that you need to fight beneath the bed each night to be a grown up.
Just when I grow up, get on the chin and wear it, nothing will change. When I grow
just because I find myself in this story, it doesn't mean that everything was written for me. If I think the ending is fixed already, I might as well be saying I think that it's okay. And that's not right.
Hello, Matilda. Back at the library again, are we?
Yes.
How are you enjoying school?
Well, I'm enjoying it. Bits of it, anyway. Miss Phelps, do you have a revenge section?
A revenge section? Well, not necessarily. Why? Is there a child at school behaving like a bully towards you?
Oh, no. Not a child, anyway.
Matilda, are you sure there isn't anything?
Do you want to hear the next part of the story?
Story? Did you say story? What are we waiting for?
Slowly, very slowly, the acrobat wound his shiny white scarf around the husband's neck. "For luck, my love," she said, kissing him with the gentlest of kisses. "Smile, we've done this 1,000 times before." Then, suddenly, she hugged him with the biggest hug in the entire world, so big he thought she would squeeze all of the air out of him. Then, they prepared to perform the most dangerous feat ever. The escapologist had to escape from the cage, lean out, catch his wife with one hand, grab the fire extinguisher with the other, and put out the flames from her wife's specially designed dress all within 12 seconds before the flames reached the dynamite on her head and blew his wife's head off.
Sorry, continue.
The trick started off well. The moment the acrobat's specially designed dress went up in flames, she swung into the air. The crowd watched as she swung over sharks and spiky objects. 1 second, 2 seconds. They held their breath as the flames crept up her dress. 3 seconds, 4 seconds. She reached her arms out towards the cage. 5 seconds, 6 seconds. Suddenly, the huge padlocks pinged open and the heavy chains fell away. 7 seconds, 8 seconds. The escapologist flung the door open and reached one huge, muscled arm out towards the cage. 9 seconds, 10 seconds.
I can't watch.
11 seconds, and she grabs her hand, and the flames are covered in foam before they can both be blown to pieces.
So a happy ending.
No.
No?
No. Perhaps it was the nerves. Perhaps it was the thought of the child, but the escapologist used a touch too much foam, and suddenly the hands became slippery and she fell.
What? No, is she okay? Did she survive?
She broke every bone in her body, except for the ones at the end of her little fingers. She did manage to live long enough to have the child, but the effort was too great. "Love our girl," she said. "Love our little girl with all your heart. She is all we have ever wanted." She died. And then things got worse.
Worse? How could things have gotten worse?
I'm afraid so. Because the escapologist was so kind, he never for 1 second suspected the acrobat's sister for what happened. In fact, he asked her to move in with her and help look after their girl. She was nothing but cruel to her, begging her wash, cook, iron, clean, and beating her for the littlest of things wrong. but always in secret, so the escapole just never found out. And so, the little girl grew up with the cruelest, meanest, horriblest aunt you could ever imagine.
Let's call the police.
Miss Phelps, it's just a story.
Oh, right, of course. Oh, Matilda, your parents think that must have think they won the lottery with having a girl as clever as you.
Oh, yes. They're always saying that, in fact. They say, Matilda, we're so proud to have a daughter like you. You're like winning the lottery. Yeah. I better go.
I'm so clever. I'm so very, very, very clever. I'm so very flaming clever. What a very clever fella I am. Come here, you.
Stop! There's only one man I'll do that with.
Gather round. I want to share my triumph with my family. Not you, boy.
Here we go.
155 old daggers on my hands, all polished up, but the mileage on the clock telling the truth that these cards were knackered. How could I possibly make the mileage go down? I couldn't very well drive each car backwards, could I?
Backwards?
Well, then I have the most genius idea. I ran into the workshop, grabbed the drill, and using my incredible mind, attached it to the speedometer, the first car, and locked it into reverse.
Backwards.
Yes, son, backwards. Backwards. A drill's motor turns thousands of times a second, and within a few minutes, I reduced the mileage on that old rust bucket to practically nothing. I did it to every single car.
Backwards.
Stop talking now, darling. There's a good boy.
10 minutes later, the Russians show up. Great, big, strong, scary-faced apes they were. Don't know who they think they were. Wearing dark sunglasses and expensive suits. Yeah.
Russians are nocturnal. I saw that on a program last night.
That was badgers. That was a program about badgers.
Same thing. And did it work? I'm a fantastic girl! Now I get a photo of Rudolph all day long!
But you cheated them! They've trusted you and just cheated them!
What's the matter with you? What have we done to deserve a child like you?
You know what I'm going to do tomorrow? I'm going to march out to a library of yours and tell that old hag you're never to be allowed in again!
But no, please don't!
And if she does let you in, I'm going to have her fired! And you'll never read another book or tell another story again in your life. Now get in there and stay in there, you nasty little creep.
That night, the escape bulger's daughter cried herself to sleep in her room. She never told anyone about her evil aunt, as she didn't want to cause a fuss. And so, she suffered in silence. But this only pushed the aunt to greater cruelties, until one day, she exploded. You are a useless, filthy, nasty little creep! And she beat her. Threw her into a dank, dark, dusty cellar, locked the door, and went out. But that night, the escapologist happened to come home early, and when he heard the sound of his daughter's tears, he smashed the door open.
Don't cry, dry your eyes, wipe away your tears, little girl. Forgive me, I didn't mean to desert you. Don't cry, little girl. Nothing can hurt you, nothing to fear. I'm here.
Have I been so wrapped up in the grief for my wife that I've forgotten the one thing that matters to us most? I love you so much, my daughter. I will spend the rest of my life making it up to you. We shall be together forever.
Hi, Daddy. I'm all right, Daddy. Please don't cry here. Let me wipe away your tears.
Forgive me.
Daddy, forgive me.
I didn't mean to desert you.
I didn't want to upset you. Please, Daddy, don't cry. I'll be all right. With you by my side, you've nothing to fear.
I'm here.
When the little girl finally fell asleep, the escapologist's mind went to the acrobat's sister, and an almighty rage grew in his heart.
This villain, this monster.
She has sullied the memory of my wife. She has betrayed the trust of her own sister. She has shown cruelties to the most precious reality of our marriage. Bullying children is her game, is it?
Is it?
Then let's see how she is when she's faced with the wrath of a grown man. But that was the last the little girl ever saw of her father, because he never came home, ever again.
Matilda, I've got those books we spoke about if you'd like.
What are you doing with those books, woman?
They're for Matilda.
I know they are not. Not on my watch. There's an age of reading, there's an age of being a filthy little toad. These are toads. Aren't you, Bogtrotter?
Yes,
Miss Trunchbull. Only Bogtrotter is now a good toad. See it.
It has become clear to me, honey, that you have absolutely no idea what you are doing. You believe in happiness and fluffiness in books and stories.
That's not teaching. To teach a child, you must first break the child. Quiet, you maggots!
But no one was speaking, Miss Trunchbull.
When I say quiet, you maggots, please understand, Miss Honey, that you are entirely included in that statement. Where's the jug of water?
I'll get it, Miss Trunchbull.
Stupid girl. Look at you! Flabby, disgusting, revolting. Revolting, I say! I say it's time we toughened you up with a little bit of fees air. This school of later started reeking. Quiet, maggots, when I'm speaking! Reeking with the most disturbing scent. Only the finest nostrils smell it, but I know it oh too well. It is the odor of rebellion. It's the bouquet of dissent! And you may bet your britches this headmistress finds this foul odoriferousness holy or factorially insulting! And so, to stop the stench's spread, I find a session of fees it salts the milly rank from the revolting. The smell of rebellion comes out in the sweat. And fizz that will get you sweating. And it won't be long before I smell the pong of aiding and abetting. a bit of fizz ed will tell us who is a headful of rebellious thoughts. Hold! Hold! Just like a rotten egg flows to the top of a bucket of water. The smell of rebellion, the stench of revolt, the reek of insubordination, the whiff of resistance, the palm of dissent, the funk of mutiny in action. Before weed becomes too big and greedy, you really need to nip it in the bud. Position two. Before the worm starts to turn, you must scrape off the dirt and rip it from the mud. A whiff of insurgence, the stench of intent, the reek of prepubescent protest, the pong of defiance, the odor of coup, the waft of anarchy in progress. Once we've exorcised these demons, they shall be too poop for scheming. Some double time discipline should stop the rot from setting in. All right, let's step it up. Double time. One, two, three, four. Discipline. Discipline for children who are listening. For minutes who are fidgeting or whispering in history. They're chattering and chittering. They're nattering and twittering. It's happened with a smattering of discipline. We must begin insisting on rigidity and discipline, persistently resisting this anarchistic mission in these minutes you are bordering on pandering and pitting. Well, looms like this, they just need discipline. The simpering, the whimpering, the dribbling, and the spittling, the misfinding, the tissue is an issue we can fix. There is no mystery to mastering the autoclash from mistress singing. It's discipline, discipline, the smell of rebellion, the stench of revolt, the freak of prepubescent plotting, the whiff of resistance, the pong of dissent, the bulk of moral fiber rotting. Woo! Imagine a world with no children. Close your eyes and just dream. Imagine, come on, try it. The peace and the quiet, a bubbling stream. Now imagine a woods with a cottage. And inside that cottage we find a dwarf called Zeke. A carnival freak who can fold paper hats with his mind, and he says, don't let them steal your horses. No, no, don't let them throw them away. If you find your way through, they'll be waiting for you, singing,
she's mine.
And there, just like I said, the sneaky magnetry is his hat. Even the squittiest, pittiest mess can harbor seeds of stickiness. Have you ever seen anything more appellant? Have you ever smelled anything worse than that smell of rebellion? The stench of revolt, the reek of insubordination, the whip of resistance, the pong of dissent. And I will not stop till you are scorched, till this rebellion is quashed, till glorious sweaty discipline has washed this sickening stench. Because you, Miss Honey, you are wet, you are weak, you in fact are a sniveling little newt. It's a newt! You!
What?
You did this, you wrong, repulsive, little sinner!
No, I didn't! No!
Once that maggot stops, we're not only just getting started.
Miss Trunchbull, no, you'll pull her ears off.
I've discovered, Miss Honey, that through the many years of experimentation, the ears of small little girls do not, in fact, come off. They stretch. I can feel these ones stretching now.
Ow!
Leave her alone, you big fat bully! How dare you? You were not fit to be in this school. You were to be in the deepest, darkest, darkest prison. So be wheeled out, strapped to Tully with the muzzle of your mouth. Oh, I shall crush you. I shall pound you. I shall dissect you, madam. I shall be wheeled out onto a table and perform little experiments on you. All these insufferable little slugs are some of the most appalling identities because of you, madam. Yes, you.
Have you ever wondered, well, I have, about how when I say red, for example, there's no way of knowing if red means the same thing in your head as red means in my head when someone says red. How if we are traveling at almost the speed of light and we're holding a light, that light will still travel away from us at the full speed of light, which seems right in a way. But I'm trying to say I'm not sure, but I wonder if inside my head I'm not just a bit different from some of my friends. These answers that come into my mind unbidden, these stories delivered to me fully written. And when everyone shouts like they seem to like shouting, the noise in my head is incredibly loud, and I just wish they'd stop. My dad and my mom and the telly and stories would stop just for once. And I'm sorry I'm not quite explaining it right, when the noise becomes anger and the anger is life, and this burning inside me would usually fade, but it isn't today. For the heat and the shouting, and my heart is pounding, and my eyes are burning, and suddenly everything is quiet. Like silence, but not really silence. Just that still sort of quiet, like the sound of a page being turned in a book. Just a pause and a walk in the woods. Quiet. Like silence, but not really silent. Just a nice kind of quiet. Just that sound when you lie upside down in your bed. Just the sound of your heart in your head. And though the people around me, the mouths are still moving, the words they are forming cannot reach me anymore. And it is quiet. And I am warm, like I've sailed into the eye of the storm.
You, miserable collection of excuses for children, and you, standing like the squid of squids are its beating heart. But I am a match for you. And I tell you, there is nothing I shall not do. No length I shall not go. No ear I shall not stretch back. No finger I shall not. What? What is that? What is it? Get it off me. Children, please, get it off. It's heading north. I've got a noose in my knickers. I got a noose in my knickers!
while we still can. Matilda.
Watch.
Matilda, we should watch, please. I moved it with my eyes. Am I strange? How do you fancy a nice cup of tea? What do you think it is, this thing with my eyes? I can't say that I know, Matilda, but I don't think it's something we should be afraid of. I'm sure it has something to do with that incredible mind of yours.
So you mean that there's not enough room in my head for all my brain so they have to squish out through my eyes?
Well, yes, something like that. I met your mother. She's unusual. What about your father? Is he proud to have a daughter as brilliant as you?
Oh, yeah. He's very proud. He's very, very proud. He's always saying that, in fact. He says, Matilda, we're so proud. That's not true, Miss Honey. That's not what he says at all. He calls me a liar and a cheat and a nasty little creep.
I see. Here we are, home sweet home.
Are you poor?
Well, yes, I am. Very.
Don't they pay teachers very much?
Well, they don't, but you see, I'm even poorer than most because of other reasons. You see, I used to live with my aunt, but one day I was walking in the woods and I came across this old little shed. So I begged the farmer to let me move in. He thought I was mad, but he agreed. And I've lived here ever since.
But, Miss Honey, you can't live in a shed.
I'm not strong like you, Matilda. You see, my father died when I was very young. Magnus was his name. He was very kind. But when he was gone, my aunt became my legal guardian. And she was mean and cruel like you can hardly imagine. And when I got my job as a teacher, she'd written everything down for taking care of me all these years. Every tea bag, every electricity bill, every tin of beans. And she'd made me sign a contract to promise to pay her back every penny. She'd even produced a document that said Magnus had given her his entire house.
But do you really think he did that? Magnus, I mean, do you really think he just gave her his house?
I can't say that I know, Matilda. Years of living with that woman made me, well, pathetic.
And that's why you live here.
This roof keeps me dry when the rain falls. This door helps to keep the cold at bay. On this floor I can stand on my own two feet. On this chair I can write my lessons. Or through this window I can watch the seasons change. By this lamp I can read. And I am set free. It isn't much, but it is enough for me. It isn't much, but it is enough.
But, Miss Honey, she has everything that's yours.
On these walls I hang wonderful pictures. Through this window I can watch the seasons change. By this lamp I can read. And I am set free. And when it's cold outside I feel no fear. Even in the winter storms I am warmed by a small but stubborn fire. And there is no It isn't much, but it is enough for me. For this is my house. This is my house.
It isn't much, but it is enough for me. For this is my
father's scarf?
Well, yes, it is. My mother gave it to him. You see, she's
an acrobat.
Well, yes, and my father's
an escapologist.
Matilda, how do you know that?
So they were your parents?
What? Who? I...
The people in my story!
What story?
A story. I've been telling a story, and I thought I'd been making it up, but it's real. It's your life. I've seen your life.
You've seen my life.
She did him in. Let's go to the police.
No, Matilda, we can't. We haven't got any evidence.
But we can just tell them. Tell them she did it.
They would never believe that she was capable of murder. It'd be a hard word against hers.
But she was so cruel to you. I mean, she beat you, threw you into cupboards, and locked you in cellars.
Stop, Matilda, please.
Miss Honey, your aunt's a murderer. Who is she?
Our contract is a contract is a contract.
Miss Churchful.
In this world, children, there are two types of human being, the winners and the losers. And I am a winner. I play by the rules and I win. And if I play by the rules and I do not win, then something is wrong. Something isn't working. And when something is wrong, you must put it right, even if it screams. This class is going to have a very special spelling test, and any child who gets any single question wrong shall go to Chalky! You spell, let me see, newt.
Newt. N-E-W-T. Newt.
What?
Miss Honey taught us. She's very good at teaching.
Nonsense. Miss Honey's too soft and peachy to be good at anything. Anyone can see that. You spell something you all are. Revolting.
R-E-V-O-L-T-I-N-G. Revolting.
You're cheating!
She's not cheating. She's simply spelling the word.
These little specks of dust cannot be this clever.
I taught them, that's all. With kindness and patience and respect.
How dare you bring those ones into my classroom? You know nothing of teaching, I shall prove it. You, flipball, snot nose, spell. Amateur pedo arialiosis.
What? But that's not even a real word.
Spell. I'll go too choky, and I should warn you. It does have some silent letters.
A-L-L-A.
Oh, oh dear.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. It was a silent Z. You're going to Turkey!
Cat. C-A-F, cat.
I get it wrong, miss. I guess you have to put me in Chokey too.
What?
Dog. D-Y-P. And me.
Table. X-A-B-F-Y. And me.
What are you doing? Stop!
Banana. G-T-A-A-B-L. You can't put us all in Chokey.
Stop!
Maggots. D-S-P-A-T-Y-F. And me, miss.
Snotnews. U-T-O-O-Q-Q-Q. And me.
No. What is this?
Naughty. P-U-F-T-X-Y-N.
Big fat bully. P-Y-T-L-F-D-R-V-S-W.
Revolting. P-X-Q-Q-Q-A-S-T. 1, 2, 3, 4, 8, 9, S. Revolting.
can't put us all in turkey. You have to put me in turkey too, miss. Come now, maggots. You really think I hadn't thought of that? A whole array of turkeys for each and every one of you. And now that the little spelling test is over, I can tell you that each and every single one of you has failed. You see, in this world, children, there are two types of human being.
The chalk, look, the chalk. It's moving.
It's writing something.
What?
Agatha. This is Magnus.
No, it can't be. Who's doing this?
Give my Jenny back her.
Magnus! It simply cannot be! What?
Then leave!
No. No. It can't be!
Or I will get you like you got me!
No. No! No!
Run!
No!
Run!
No!
Says I'm a miracle. Never again.
Never again will we live behind walls.
Never again. Revolting children living in revolting times. We sing revolting songs, using revolting rhymes. We'll be revolting children till our revolting's done, and we'll have the church called revolting. We're revolting. We are revolting children.
Daughter receives a mysterious letter from a solicitor. It had said that her parents' will mysteriously turned up, and she was now the owner of the beautiful big old house. She moved in immediately and was happy, happier than she'd been in her entire life. That house, up until that moment, had been owned by the evil aunt, one Agatha Trunchbull.
And do you know something else? Miss Trunchbull was never seen or heard from again, and all the turkeys were immediately destroyed. And a new headmistress took over.
And her name was Miss Honey. and it was said to be the best school in all the land.
And one other thing. Matilda was never again able to move things with her mind. She said it was because she no longer had a need for superpowers, but I thought it was because her mind was no longer being challenged. And sometimes I would look at this little girl who had done so much to help others, but was stuck with parents who were mean and cruel to her. And it would just make my blood boil, and I would just wish that I could do something.
So I guess this is the end. And I wish I could tell you that Matilda got all the love she deserved. But I guess the truth is, not all stories have happy endings.
Don't stand there, Dorby, we're going to Spain!
Spain? But why?
Because this idiot, this nit, this twit brain, decided it was a good idea to sell 155 old bangers to the Russian mafia!
I didn't know the flaming Russian mafia, did I? Now come on, we're leaving forever, we're never coming back!
Wait! Let Matilda stay here with me!
I beg your pardon?
I would love to take care of her, and I'd take care of her with love and respect, and I'd pay for everything.
You mean your daughter? Here, with you!
What, do you just call me?
They'll be here any minute!
You just called me your daughter.
They're here, you idiots, I told you!
Quick, behind the books!
What if they damage my legs? My beautiful legs.
You are the woman's daughter?
Yes.
Where is your father?
He's... I don't know.
The Mormont is a stupid man. And being stupid, he assumed I was stupid too. And that is a very, very stupid and rude thing to do.
Oh yes, well my father is quite rude and very, very stupid.
You know this? This is one clever one in the family. What is your name, little girl?
Matilda.
I like you, Matilda. You seem smart. Sadly, in my line of work, I don't often get to meet smart people like you. Most of the people I deal with, their thinking is all backwards.
Backwards!
Dashek Petraviosa, and she even covers for her wrath of a father.
See you
yes, back. It is a pleasure to meet you, Chica.
Dobrze przyjadna, pas maku mito s vami. And it is a pleasure to meet you, too.
Ty govoriš po-ruski? You speak Russian?
Well, not as well as I would like to. It's a beautiful language, and I hope I can learn as much as I can.
Who taught you how to speak Russian?
Well, I taught myself. You see, I was reading Dostoevsky, and I thought it would be much better if I read it in its original language.
I'm Sergei. It is truly an honor to meet you, Matilda Warlock. Your father has been stupid and rude to both of us, yes? I can very easily have one of my friends teach him manners. And one day, when he leaves hospital, he will still be stupid, but not so rude, I think. I give this as a gift to you. What do you say?
Mr. Sergei, that is a very tempting offer, but he's my father. I'm his daughter. I think I've had enough revenge.
This little girl, this miracle, Matilda.
Da?
Da? No, start with the yes. What are you doing?
I thought you said yes.
I thought you said yes as well.
Matilda, yes, cousin Matilda. What is the matter with you guys today?
Sorry, boss. Sorry.
Matilda, your father is a very, very stupid man. But he is also very, 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 very lucky to have you as his daughter. Although, if I happen to be doing business here again, he will not be so lucky.
Quick, let's go before they change their minds!
But what about the girls? Want to stay here? With Miss Honey?
Yes, yes I do.
And you? You want to take care of her?
Yes, I do.
Well, we're all out of space, so... Yes, bye-bye!
Thank you! And Matilda leapt into Miss Honey's arms
and hugged her.
And Miss Honey hugged her back.
And they hardly noticed as the Wormwoods
and Rudolfo.
And they hardly noticed as the Wormwoods and Rudolfo sped away into the distance.
Because they had found each other.
Yes, they had found each other.
have to be...
Really amazing. So, we have another performance.